just bed and get home every evening, and history's repeating, turning off my phone cause it's hurting my chest. Yeah, and heaven knows I'm not happy.
Welcome everyone.
Can't sit and hope, I can't just sit and pray that I can find the love when all I see is pain. Falling to my knees, and though I do believe, I can't just breathe, baby, breathe.
Thank you for joining us.
Harry, once you start, and hey everybody, welcome in. I'm gonna highlight you two on the screen so I fade to the background. We'll start with Hasan, actually, when he's going, right? Yeah.
Sounds good.
I'll highlight you first, Harry, and then Hasan, right. And then, okay.
Ready to begin? Thanks for joining us, everyone. We'll give it another second for people to join. All right. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us this evening for the Institute for Common Powers Truth Matters Initiative. Before we get going this evening, I wanted to acknowledge that today is an incredibly important anniversary. Today, on March 7th, 1965, is a day that 600 incredibly brave men, women, and children chose to walk two by two across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in protest over the murder of Jimmie Lee Jackson and the inability to vote. They were met by Sheriff Jim Clark's men and others on posse and beaten and gassed. And their incredibly courageous efforts led to, by March 25th, 25,000 people arriving in Montgomery, Alabama, taking that 54-mile march to the steps of the Capitol where George Wallace was inside. And by August 6th, the 1965 Voting Rights Act had begun. So I wanted to acknowledge Bloody Sunday, that anniversary today. We are here to hear from Dr. Hasan Kwame Jeffries. He's going to lecture to us today about We Are Our History, Obstacles and Opportunities for Teaching American History Honestly Today. And before we get into that, I wanted to do a couple of things. First of all, I want to talk a bit about Common Power and the Institute for Common Power. This is being brought to you today by Common Power. And then Dr. Jeffries will talk for about 30 minutes. And then Dr. David Domke, my colleague from Common Power, will join Dr. Jeffries and I for a conversation about the state of this attack on education in the country today and what we can do about it. You will have an opportunity to post questions in the question and answer box. You may do that all throughout. Once we get to the question and answer portion, we will definitely take your questions. My name is Dr. Terry Ann Scott. I'm a former professor of African American and United States history at Hood College in Maryland, and I was chair of the department. Previous to that, I taught at the University of Washington. I made a choice to leave that tenured position last summer to become the director of the Institute for Common Power. Common Power is a voting justice organization that is based in Seattle, but we knock on doors all over the country. Just in Georgia alone, at the end of 2022, we knocked on over 10,000 doors. We were in 10 states in 2022. We register people to vote and we push for a just and equal democracy. The Institute for Common Power started last June as an educational branch for Common Power. We understand that to sustain people's efforts in pushing for this just and inclusive democracy, we must help them understand the gravity of the issues that we face today. And we do that by understanding where we come from so that we know where we are going. We do that through a variety of things, including lectures and workshops and conferences, conversations like the one we're going to have tonight. We have a truth and purpose learning tour, where we give educators K through 12 scholarships and take them on a journey of African-American history through the South several times per year. And we have so much more. Because of what's happening in this country today, we decided to start what is called our Truth Matters Initiative. And I wanted to read you our statement on that. We are confronted today in America by an attack on truth in education. It is an attempt by politically motivated individuals, government offices, and politicians to halt the full teaching of American life by eradicating terrible and painful, but fully truthful aspects of our past, present, and potential future. At their core, such attacks seek to erase the triumphs of African Americans and how they have been vital to building this nation, especially in the struggle for civil rights and voting justice. The Institute for Common Power cannot and will not idly watch. The Institute's Truth Matters Initiative is committed to teaching truth, to countering those who are trying to silence it, to supporting educators who stand for truth, to partnering with organizations and leaders who are committed to combating efforts to erase truth from existence. Just today, Florida Governor Ron DeSantis gave his State of the State address, a speech that also seems to further signal that he is going to run for the presidency. He redoubled his promise to limit the teaching of truth and prevent teachers from using student-preferred pronouns and so much more. He already banned the implementation of African-American studies as an AP course. House Bill 999, presented recently in Florida, will place professors at risk of losing tenure and being fired for teaching aspects of history that explore truth and structural racism. It ends spending on programs that support diversity training and gender studies. It includes many additional measures that promise to attack the teaching of African-American history and stoke fear in educators. And it's not just in Florida, folks. This is happening in places across the country. We're here to help stop this, and we will discuss ways to do that this evening and in the coming days. This is why we are so honored to have Dr. Hasan Jeffries with us tonight. Dr. Jeffries is an associate professor of history at The Ohio State University, who teaches, researches, and writes about the African-American experience from a historical perspective. He's chronicled the civil rights movement in the 10-episode Audible original series, Great Figures of the Civil Rights Movement, and has told the remarkable story of the original Black Panther Party in Bloody Lounge, Civil Rights and Black Power in Alabama's Black Belt, which has been praised as, quote, the book historians of the Black Freedom Movement have been waiting for. Dr. Jeffries has collaborated on several public history projects, including serving as the lead scholar and primary script writer for the $27 million renovation and redesign of the National Civil Rights Museum at the Lorraine Hotel in Memphis, Tennessee, the site of the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in 1968. Dr. Jeffries regularly shares his experiences on African-American history and contemporary Black politics through public lectures, op-eds, and interviews with print, radio, and television news outlets, including the New York Times, the Los Angeles Times, NPR, CNN, and MSNBC. Dr. Jeffries takes great pride in opening students' minds to find new ways of understanding the past and the present. For his pedagogical creativity and effectiveness, he has received numerous awards, including Ohio State's highest honor, the Ohio State Alumni Award for Distinguished Teaching. Please help me welcome Dr. Hasan Kwame Jeffries.
Well, Terry, thank you so much, David as well, for the warm welcome. It is really a distinct honor and pleasure and privilege to be able to share some thoughts and ideas on this important topic at this important moment with this broader public, with this broader community. So thank you both. Thank you to the Institute for Common Power for enabling us to have this discussion. And thank you to all those who have tuned in on this evening, Tuesday evening. There's a lot of other things that you can be doing. So I'm really grateful that you've taken this time out to spend some time with us discussing this important topic. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. I have a few slides. I kind of want to walk us through a little bit of how we got to this moment and how people have responded to similar moments in the past. So we are our history, obstacles and opportunities for teaching American history honestly today. I want us to go back just a few years first, to August of 2019, which marked the 400 years after the first enslaved Africans were brought to these shores, sold in chains and into bondage for most in Virginia. So 2019, August of 2019, marked 400 years since the first Africans, what would become later on African-Americans, our descendants, arrived in British colonial America. A number of organizations, a number of newspapers, a number of scholarly organizations, universities, including Ohio State, marked the moment with seminars and lectures and the like. The New York Times had its 1619 project. The Washington Post did something similar. USA Today did a wonderful piece, series using infographics, talking about what the slave trade was, what slavery was, how it evolved and its lasting legacy. But this conversation about not just what happened in 1619, 400 years ago, because 1619, after all, is just a date, but what did that mean for the development of America and this nation over time? America's commitment, not just to the institution of slavery, but to a belief system rooted in white supremacy that justified the exploitation and the enslavement of African people for 2.5 centuries. And then what is the legacy of the institution of slavery? Its primary legacy, of course, is the belief in white supremacy and how that persists, not only in the few years immediately after slavery ends, but for a full century in which we see legalized segregation, and then for another half century after that, as we wrestle with things like the war on drugs and mass incarceration, which are justified in part by a belief in white supremacy. So this conversation that this 400 year moment sparked should have been a moment of reflection, a moment of celebration in a sense that Black folk, we still here and we survived all of that and we're still going strong. But for some, it was something heinous. It was something un-American. It was something unpatriotic. And while in the moment it didn't quite lead to the hysteria that we would see in a little bit, there were already very, very clear murmurs coming from the political right that somehow this critical analysis of America from slavery into the present was dangerous. August of 2019. If we fast forward just a little bit to June of 2020, of course, in May of 2020, we see the killing of the murder of George Floyd in Minneapolis, Minnesota, sparking a wave of protests, not only across the nation, but across the globe. And June 2020 is really critical. It's critical to all that will happen afterward. Because in June of 2020 and in July of 2020, in response to the murder of George Floyd, in response to the murder of Breonna Taylor and the lynching of Ahmaud Arbery, more Americans took to the streets than at any other time in American history. And it's not even close. The March on Washington in August of 1963 was one evening, 250,000 people. In June of 2020, 25 to 30 million people took to the streets protesting for the victim, for justice for the victims of police violence. The next month in July, an equal number took to the streets. And it's important to note, and this is what became really concerning for those who benefit from the status quo. People weren't just calling for justice for the victims of police violence, or even under the banner of Black Lives Matter, calling for a recognition of Black humanity and fair treatment. They were also calling for an end to systemic racism. They were demanding an end to systemic racism. Now here's the difference. Black folk been calling for, have understood the problem of systemic racism, whether it was called structural racism or institutional racism. I mean, that's what Black Power was all about. It was a critique of existing systems and structures. You ask those 20 and odd Negroes, as they were called in 1619 when they arrived on the shores, is this just a couple bad white people, or is this a system that needs to be broken? They understood what institutional racism was and what it looked like. But what we saw in summer of 2020, though, was unique, because the vast majority of people who were protesting were white people, right? Led certainly and organized by African-Americans and folk who had been fighting under the banner of Black Lives Matter for more than half a decade at that point. But the majority were white folk and young people. And not only were they calling and demanding themselves an end to systemic racism in a very public way, they were going back home and having conversations in the suburbs with their parents, in these rural communities with their parents. And that really shook a lot of people to the core, not only because the conversations were being had, but because institutions were responding, right? Corporations were responding. State boards of education were responding. Here in Ohio, the State Board of Education in June, in response to the protests that were taking place in the middle of a global pandemic, issued a very powerful statement acknowledging their complicity in perpetuating systemic racism and asserting that they would, a commitment to do a better job going forward. So the protests were absolutely having an effect. And how could they not? Again, these were the largest protests in American history. In September of 2020, so just a few months later, we already begin to see the seeds of a response. So we cannot separate what will come in the years after from the 2020 presidential election, because the former president of the United States, Donald Trump, desperate to still cling on to those white voters who were animated by white supremacy, we must remember that racism is the most powerful political ideology that America has ever created. And Donald Trump, the former president of the United States, for all that he does not know, he certainly knew that and was not afraid to tap into it and rely on it to animate his base. And so that manifests itself in September of 2020 with him signing an executive order for this thing called the 1776 Commission. Now here's where that 1619 project, and more specifically, the critique of America that is embedded in it, saying, look, we got some stuff right to be sure, but we got a whole lot of stuff wrong, a whole lot of stuff wrong. That feeds into that call for systemic racism. This then becomes the counter response. Now, this isn't the brainchild of Donald Trump. I mean, this is something, this critique of systemic racism and how can we respond to systemic racism is coming from the political right and particularly the think tanks like the Heritage Foundation and the like, who are going to politicize this. Because here's the thing that we have to understand. There's really only two responses that you can have to critiques of systemic racism, right? One, actually do something, meaning address the structural inequality that's born of the systems and structures that govern our society. Or you can do absolutely nothing. But if you do nothing, you have to be able to justify that to the public. And the way in which those who benefit from the existing status quo, who benefit from economic systems and political systems and social systems that perpetuate inequality, the way they justify doing nothing in response to these demands for an end to systemic racism was by saying that systemic racism isn't real. And that's what this whole 1776 commission was all about, the counter to this sort of 1619 project that then becomes a euphemism for all analyses of systemic racism in America, in American history. Now, this would be like so many other things that Donald Trump puts before the nation. It would be cute if we could just dismiss it, right? I mean, I doubt he even read what the executive order said himself. But here's the problem. What the language in the executive order that he signed then becomes the blueprint for all of the other anti, quote unquote, CRT, anti-divisive issues, anti-woke legislation that we will then see coming down the road. All of it is copycat legislation based upon what was originally put forward by the Trump administration, which was handed to him by these political conservative think tanks in September of 2020 in order to gin up support for this coming election. But then we all know what happens. Donald Trump loses. He loses the election, and someone should probably still tell him that he actually still lost, but he loses the election. And of course, on January 2021, we see the unimaginable. We see something that is truly shocking in the sense that we had never seen an attempt by US citizens, by Americans, to stop the peaceful transfer of power through the use of force and violence. But of course, if we know a little bit of US history, we shouldn't have been that surprised by the use of white supremacy in particular, or trying to preserve white supremacy through the use of violence. But here's the thing. We'll come back to January 6th. But here's the thing. Trump loses. And again, this what we're seeing in this, the attack on education is really rooted in politics, because there's two things that happen after Trump loses the election of 2020. The first thing is that that red states, political conservatives, Republican-controlled state legislatures, immediately begin to pass a wave of voter suppression mechanisms and laws. This is January of 2021, right? Now this, and Georgia leads the way. Sweet Georgia, right? Leads the way by passing, beginning to gin up these voter suppression mechanisms. Why was that important? Because what we actually saw in the election of November of 2020 was the largest turnout in American history, and it occurred in the middle of a pandemic, right? We're losing a million people, right? Hundreds of thousands of folks are dying, and yet we saw the largest turnout. Those on the political right, political conservatives, understood that they would not win going forward unless they changed the rules of the game. And knowing that they now could, because the Supreme Court under John Roberts had stripped the Voting Rights Act of its teeth in 2013 in Shelby versus Holder, there is no check on the discriminatory laws that they could pass with regard to voting rights. So we see it in January 2021, the beginning of this wave of voter suppression mechanisms. But then very shortly after that, by June of 2021, so this is just 4 or 5 months later, we then see all of these critical race theory bans. There's a connection. On the one hand, you have this effort to suppress the vote of young people, of African Americans, of lower income, of seniors, those who traditionally would vote Democratic. And these anti-critical race theory or critical race theory bans, that's designed to turn out the vote on the right. So you suppress the vote on the left, and then you animate and turn out the vote on the right, understanding that, again, playing to this idea of the internalized racist beliefs of that core constituency. They felt that they lost Trump. Trump's power was able to really turn out the white vote. And these critical, and with the critical race theory bans, it's not just that they're banning sort of critical race theory, knowing, of course, that, look, just take a step back. What is critical race theory? It ain't that complicated. It really ain't that complicated. All it simply is saying is a framework for understanding America's past and present that simply says, in order to understand America's past and present, you have to take seriously the role of race and racism in society. That's it. Ain't no mystery. Ain't no secret. Taught in law schools. Been around for 40 years. It ain't that complicated. But there's a political, what we're seeing here actually isn't sort of, it's framed as, oh, parents are upset. This is about parental control. No, this is political hysteria ginned up by the same people who were passing those voter suppression laws, because they wanted to keep that the base that Trump had animated still engaged. And this was the way to do it. But it was so insidious, and the messaging of it. Look, you know, did the political right, you know, one of the things that the political right did that I think those who are committed to teaching history honestly and effectively, they got so far out ahead of it that by the time people seriously said, okay, we got to respond to this, it was almost too late. They had hijacked the term critical race theory and put, and purposefully, this wasn't an accident, and put under this umbrella term everything that was designed to scare white people, right? Like, your children are being indoctrinated and told to hate one another and hate themselves and hate whiteness and all this other silliness, of none of which is occurring, right? Nobody is blaming little Kylie for slavery, right? And nobody's blaming little Kylie for all the problems we are going on today. At most, people are saying, look, you got to deal with the past. You got to understand the past so you can make sense of the present, so you can do what? Because your child, our children, the ones we are teaching, are responsible for the future. Right. And so if they don't understand the past, if they can't make sense of the present, then they won't be able to address and solve the problems that are presented to them in the future, the problems that we haven't solved ourselves and problems are partly of our own making. And so this idea of what is being taught in the classroom really animates those voters who are parents, white parents who are worried and afraid, because let's begin to say black people. Right, Bible, like, oh, no, no, we understand the significance of race and racism. We're talking solely about white folk and political conservatives. But even other, you know, white folk who aren't necessarily that deeply engaged, like, hold on, there's something here that don't sound right, right? And that really ended. And we see the fruits of that in the gubernatorial race in Virginia with Glenn Youngkin winning and running on this idea, right, of we have to protect our children, our white children, the sensitivity of it, and make sure they feel comfortable in the classroom. Right. And so we see then not just these critical race theory bans, but we see this broader legislation talking about divisive issues and topics and subjects. I mean, that then becomes absurd. Right. Then you can't even they want us that they're calling for teaching a history that never happened. The year after, this is June of 2020, and they begin to trickle slowly forward over the next year, spreading pretty wide. On the anniversary of January 6th, President Joe Biden gives a very powerful, the first anniversary, a very powerful speech that you all may remember. So it's January 6th of 2022. And I'm watching it. And like most of us, I imagine, I'm watching, I'm paying attention, I'm going along. I'm riding with Joe on this. He's like, look, this is domestic terrorism. We got to understand this, right? And then he gets to a point, and it's around a 19-minute mark. You can go to C-SPAN. C-SPAN keeps everything, right? You can go see that. And around a 19-minute mark, Joe Biden says, about January 6th, he says, this is not who we are. This is not who we have ever been. This is what he said. Quote, this is not who we are. This is not who we have ever been. And I was like, Joe, are you sure? Are you sure about that, Joe? Because as he's talking about political violence specifically, right? He's like, political violence is not who we are. This is not who we have ever been. And I was like, American Revolution, political violence. Civil War, political violence. Wilmington, North Carolina, the end of Reconstruction, political violence. The effort to suppress the civil rights movement, the bombing of Harry and Henriette Moore down in Florida in 1951, political violence. The bombing of 16th Street Baptist Church in 1963, political violence. The assaults on the Black Panthers and others during the Black Power era, political violence. What happened in 2015 in Charleston, South Carolina, with the killing of 9 souls in Mother Emanuel Church, political violence. What we saw in Charlottesville, political violence. And so this, the answer to that question of this is not who we are, or the point, the response is, well, then who are we? Because it appears that this is exactly who we are. And, you know, whenever in doubt, I believe you turn to James Baldwin. And James Baldwin said, in response to the question of who are we, James Baldwin said, we are our history. We are our history. And so that just doesn't mean the good stuff, right? That means all of it. That means the political violence. That means the racism. That means the slavery. That means the Jim Crow. That means the discrimination. That means the unjust mass incarceration of people. That's actually who we are as a nation. That doesn't make us today individually bad people. That just makes us the product of a world in the past that hopefully is different than the one that we're living in now, but isn't that far away. We are our history. But all of those aspects, the persistence of inequality, because that's been baked into the systems and structures that govern and shape our lives, is exactly what many don't want us to deal with. So to be sure, the governor of Florida, Ron DeSantis, is playing politics, right? DeSantis is a graduate. I think he went to what, Yale? I heard Yale's a pretty good school. I know some faculty members up there. He knows all of this history. He has a degree in history, for God's sake, right? You didn't come through Yale without learning about this. You know what Reconstruction was all about, but he's pretending that he doesn't. And he's pretending, which is a terrible thing to do, right? That it has all this untoward impact on this, on children, right? This isn't about children. This is about politics. But there is an element of it that moves beyond politics, right? There is an element of it that is rooted in not wanting to talk about the past. Because if you talk honestly about the past, then what do you have to do? Then you got to deal with the legacy of it in the present, right? You can't pretend as though systemic racism isn't real if you're talking honestly about the past. And this is what, again, this is a, going back to just 2 years earlier, when you have all those white kids who are coming home talking about, Ma, I think we need to talk about this thing called systemic racism, right? How is that going to change the future? That's going to change the future. And so he doesn't want to deal with that. And then all of these other, again, state legislatures that are that have such, you know, super majorities here in Ohio as well, partly due to gerrymandering and all these other factors, right, then begin to pass, double down on these measures and these bills. The great irony, of course, as Ron DeSantis, you know, passes his anti-woke legislation, and then, as Terry pointed out in January, says, nope, we're not going to deal with African-American studies, we're not going to deal with African-American history, and in fact says that African-American studies has no educational value. Literally said, has no educational value. Has no educational value. Because what does African-American history, what does African-American studies actually bring to the table? It brings it provides a prism through which to view the American past that is more truthful than any other that you could possibly use. And he doesn't want to deal with that. And they don't want to deal with that, those on the political right, because that would require them to change the status quo, to do something about the status quo, and they don't want to deal with that. The great irony is maybe DeSantis doesn't know Florida history, because if it wasn't for African Americans at the moment of emancipation, there would be no public education in the South. There would be no public education in Florida, because it was African Americans and their deep desire and appreciation for education, for learning the fundamentals of reading and writing. Why? Because while they were enslaved, it was illegal, it was against the law to teach enslaved people and free people to read and write. Nobody had a better appreciation of education, even the most fundamental aspects of reading and writing, than people who had for generations been forbidden from learning, under penalty of death in some instances, from learning how to read and write. And so at the moment of a moment of emancipation, in states just like Florida, African-Americans are clamoring for the basics of education. They're writing petitions to the Freedmen's Bureau, demanding and asking and pleading and petitioning for what? For schools and resources and teachers and the like. And what happens? They become, those schools, those teachers become the target of racial terrorists. They become the target of Klan-like organizations. They become the target. Why? Because of the threat that education poses. And sometimes you get folks like, oh, you know, it's nice that the formerly enslaved people wanted to read and write because they wanted to study the Bible. It's like, all right, okay. Yeah, they wanted to read contracts too, right? I mean, there's a practical element to it. And they also, whether they were deeply religious or not, they also understood that education was a human right. Right, they understood that it was the point of access to power, right? You couldn't be a full citizen if you didn't have the vote in one hand and you didn't have a writing tablet in the other. So African Americans have had a deep commitment to education, which is critically important to understand, because we're also caught up in very much in this with a belief today that somehow Black people aren't committed to education, that Black people don't want to learn. Like, stop that. There's nobody who has wanted to learn more, even in the god-awful schools that we were provided, than Black folk. But when African Americans during Reconstruction are able to put Black folk into state legislatures, what's one of the first things that they do? They create a public education system. Now, they understood that it had to be segregated. They also didn't trust these old Confederates teaching their kids anyway, right? So it's like, all right, we cool, y'all go over there, we all go over here. Unfortunately, that evolved into a system that was separate and fundamentally unequal. But African Americans are the ones who were responsible for public education in the first place. A lot of the conversation that revolved that we hear today around this anti-wokeness and all this other silliness that they say, it's like, it's okay, wake up. Spike Lee says, wake up. It's centered around what? Indoctrination. Like, oh, this is indoctrination. And we know this is indoctrination. This is an indoctrination. Talking honestly about the American past and present is not indoctrination, right? Why? How do we know this? Because we actually know what educational indoctrination looks like in American history, right? In September of 1894, those good Southern white women in the South who were committed to keeping the memory alive of the Confederacy and Confederate soldiers formed the United Daughters of the Confederacy. And these are the women who are responsible not just for keeping the cemeteries neat where the Confederate dead are buried. They're responsible for erecting, fundraising, and erecting these monuments to the Confederate cause that have littered the landscape for the last 130 plus years. But they did more than that. In addition to erecting monuments to white supremacy, right? Because that's what this is, right? And remember, they all go up right around, they start in the late 1890s, and will continue for another two decades or so, this period of erecting these monuments to white supremacy. They're done in this moment where African Americans are being disenfranchised, where former Confederates and the heirs of the Confederacy, right, are using white supremacy as a rallying cry in order to regain control of political power throughout the South. The racial terrorism and violence, right, is spreading. So it's not just that whites are disenfranchising African Americans saying don't vote. Wilmington, North Carolina, November 1898, we see an actual political coup, a successful political coup, right? In which a Black and white coalition of Republicans in Wilmington, North Carolina, the largest city in North Carolina, the most important port city at the time, right, are run out of office. And not by anybody wearing hoods and masks. Nobody in this picture is wearing a hood or mask. In fact, it was a former Democratic congressperson who led the charge and was installed at the head of the city council afterward. So what's happening when you have the Daughters of the Confederacy are putting flowers at these burial sites and these monuments and doing it in order to provide a rationalization for the political violence that is being used to overthrow and push out or limit the democracy that had the democratic gains that had been made on the part of African Americans after the Civil War. And they're doing it not just by putting up statues and monuments, but by creating a whole mythology around American history, around the institution of slavery, saying that slavery was a benign institution and enslavers were noble people, that the Civil War, that those who fought for democracy were actually those who were trying to destroy the Union itself. These were the Confederates. Saying that Reconstruction was not a bold effort to experiment in democracy, but rather was a tragedy, one that was filled with political corruption and strife that endangered the South as a whole. They create a whole mythology that we call the Lost Cause that was designed to justify and rationalize the use of violence to regain political control and economic control in the South at the turn of the 20th century. that mythology, this is the indoctrination. This is how we know how indoctrination works, because those same Southern Belles, those same women are now writing textbooks that incorporate this information. They're now forming censor boards in the 19-teens and 1920s and 1930s, some of which will stay in effect in Mississippi up until the 1950s, that have the power to decide which books can go into classrooms and which can't. We're talking about book bans. We know book bans. We know what they are. Here in America, we saw them centered around these conversations in our public schools, because people did not want to deal, white Southerners in particular, did not want to deal with the truth of what the past was. And it wasn't because they just wanted to have blinders on. It's because it served a particular political purpose. This isn't just ignorance, right? This is purposeful historical amnesia and rewriting the past for a contemporary political purpose. We've seen it before. And the educational indoctrination was about what books can go in and what books can be kept out. It was about sending. The other thing, the Daughters of the Confederacy, they're sending portraits of Robert E. Lee to schools across the country. One of their goals was to have a Confederate flag in every schoolroom in the South. Educational indoctrination. But the story doesn't end there. Although it should, because I've been talking for a while. But the story doesn't end there. In 1915, what do we have? Carter G. Woodson, right? Forming in September of 1915, the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History. This is critical. Remember, African Americans never gave up on the deep desire to have an education and not just learn to read or write. They wanted a truthful and honest education. Because all of the nonsense that was being fed to them eventually by the United Daughters of Confederacy and those white supremacists who were in control of school boards. And so Carter G. Woodson isn't just forming an organization to bring teachers and scholars together. One of the things that the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History, now the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, is doing is they're publishing textbooks. They're publishing material. So in an organized way, source materials so that teachers can use in the classroom to teach Black children the truth about America's past, the truth about America's present, the truth about Africa's past, the truth about Africa's present. And so one of the responses, one of the things to keep in mind is that Black folk have been responding to this nonsense for as long as they've had the opportunity to do so. And one of the ways in which they did it was through this coordinated effort to provide teaching materials that is grounded in historical reality and not historical fiction, and get that in the hands of K through 12 teachers. This is a photograph. If you look in the very bottom, you might see a very young debonair fella. That ain't me, that's Martin Luther King at Morehouse College, probably around 1948, which is the year that he graduated. Not only has that effort Not only had historically, particularly in the 20th century, the effort to teach history accurately and effectively, to provide young people, Black folk, because the schools are still segregated at this time, to provide young Black folk with not just an adequate education, but an accurate education, wasn't simply limited to K through 12 public schools, in which teachers have to be really covert and secretive in the textbooks that they use and how they use them. But we also see it in historically Black colleges and universities. One of the things that we now see is under assault, and Florida's at the head of it, is this isn't just being limited to K through 12, right? I mean, public colleges and universities are equally under assault for what they can teach and what they cannot teach. But there's a model in the past. What was taught at these historically Black colleges and universities, and not just the private ones like Morehouse College or Spelman's College, which Morehouse was my alma mater, but also at those Black colleges like Jackson State University, that were state universities, Alabama State University, Alabama A&M, where you have these white supremacist regimes that are closely monitoring what is going on in the classroom. And yet those teachers are still able to provide their students with the education that would eventually lead to a revolution in this country, a civil and human rights revolution. So those Black children are not being indoctrinated with white supremacy. Now, it's not perfect to be sure, but they provide a model for how at the college level, even under the pressure from the outside, they're still able to provide their students with the education that they need and the education that they deserve. During the Civil Rights Movement, we see another way in which African Americans are responding to these efforts to limit the kind of to limit what's taught to African American children, right? I mean, separate but equal. We understand that there's different resources, but what also happened in these Jim Crow schools is the material and what they were supposed to be teaching was inadequate. And so what we saw, of course, during the summer of 1964 is this pioneering experiment in creating a parallel educational structure with these freedom schools, saying, look, we're gonna provide supplemental education that's not just about reading and writing, and certainly that was involved with poetry and the like, but we're also teaching French, we're teaching Black history, we're teaching African history, we're teaching about the politics of decolonization, right? And so that freedom school model in Mississippi, developed by SNCC organizer, the theoretical underpinnings of it by Staunton Lynn and Charlie Cobb, really became a model for how to not just supplement, but to accentuate that which teachers were trying to do in the classroom, but didn't have the necessary resources, time and energy, or independence in order to do. And of course, the Freedom School model gets adopted and spread by civil rights, or by organizations that come out of the civil rights movement. Thinking here specifically of the Children's Defense Fund, who really take the Freedom School model and apply it to communities and cities around the country and are still doing that work now. That's, you know, you're gonna have these freedom schools for the young kids. And then we see in the late 1960s, right? The effort of those kids who are coming out of those schools. And now we're having desegregation of desegregation of some schools in the South, but then also a more fuller integration of white schools in the North. And we see those students with the student protests who are demanding what? Black studies. Who are demanding, and this of course was in April of 1969 at Cornell University, the takeover of the main administration building, leading to eventually the development of the Africana studies there. African Americans at predominantly white institutions demanding Black studies, demanding that African American history, African American culture, African American literature be treated be taught. And then, of course, be treated in a way with respect and dignity and on par with other disciplines. This is critical because what we're also seeing is that this is under assault, too. Clearly, Ron DeSantis is like, we're not going to deal with African-American studies, right? Just flat out saying, right? No educational value. We're not going to deal with it. That's absurd. But then it's also, you know, what springs forward from the African-American studies, the Black studies movement, is that we wind up with women's studies, we wind up with Latino studies, we wind up with LGBTQ studies, right? I mean, all of that stems from the efforts of young people. These are young people. We often think about the young sit-in activists, right? These aren't the sit-in activists. These are the cats who are like, y'all got guns, we got guns. We're gonna show up, we're gonna take over the building, and we're not leaving until you change something, right? I mean, that was the Black Power generation. And it's, we owe them just as much as we owe that 1961 civil rights generation of John Lewis and so many others. This last slide, and I'll wrap up. Come back to the present, September of 2021. We know that those protests, largest protests in the summer of 2020, largest protests in American history, the demands included not only that call for an end to police violence. Calling for justice for the victims of police violence, calling for a recognition of Black humanity. That's what those beautiful murals were that dotted the landscape. Calling for an end to systemic racism that shook those white folk to the core. But then also, and I don't think we appreciate this enough, the call for the removal of those statues that the Daughters of Confederacy had put up a century before. The removal of the names or changing of the names of streets and the names of schools, like that was all led by young people, all led by students. Certainly they were not the first. Black folk had been like, as soon as those monuments, you know, most of them cheap anyway, went up, they were like, look, them damn things need to come down, right? You know, that had been an ongoing issue within the African-American community. But young folk in this moment zeroed in on that during their protest. Why? Because they understood that they have been given, they have been taught, they have been fed a history, a version of the past that just simply wasn't true. And this was their demand, that we get it right, that we start teaching history accurately. And so in September of 2021, that Robert E. Lee statue finally comes down, and so many others come down in Richmond and elsewhere. But here's the opportunity. We know the obstacles. The obstacles are those on the political right who want to use this as a football to keep those who are animated by racism engaged on their side in the political world. But here's the opportunity. The opportunity is that our kids are demanding to know the truth. Young people are telling us, they told us, they were willing to go out in the streets facing highly militarized police, putting their lives on the line, not only for that justice, but also so that they could be told what was true about America's past and present. Our children are demanding, our students are demanding that we actually teach them the truth. They're demanding it of us. And as teachers, and as parents, we have an obligation to teach the truth. We have an obligation to tell our kids the truth about the past so that they can make sense of the present, so that they can address those problems that we have been unable to solve in the future. That's scary to some. It's threatening to others. It's uncomfortable to many of us. But we have no choice but to do it. And our kids are telling us that we have to do it. So with that, I will stop sharing my screen and invite David and Terry back in, and we can keep the conversation going. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Hasan Jeffries. Thank you so much for examining where we are today, how we have arrived at this present moment. And also thank you so much for highlighting Black agency with ASALA, Dr. Carter G. Woodson's organization, with the emergence of HBCUs, with the Freedom Schools. There is a message in the methodology and lessons for us to learn from the actions of those who pushed against efforts to subvert our history. So thank you for that. With that, I want to bring Dr. David Domke back into this conversation. I know there are a lot of questions that people have.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Jeffries, for that painful but real journey through what America really is. And I'm a person who studies political communication and messages, and politicians lie to us all the time. Sometimes they're genuinely lying about a factual thing, but more often they're just lying about our mythologies, about who we are. You know, that like this could never happen in America. No, this happens all the time in America, right? Of course. So if that's who we are, if that's fundamentally who we are, what is the very first thing that we need to do, or we need to help to enact, not just the three of us, but we as a society? What is the very first thing we need to have? I'm not asking you to solve this. I'm just asking the first step. Terry, I'd love to get your answer to this first. What's the first step to address this assault on truth in education that is occurring from politically motivated individuals who are the George Wallace updates of this era?
Right. There are so many steps, and it's really, I find it challenging to privilege one over the other. So when you say, what are the steps, there are many things that we can do. And I think it's important to recognize that, because everybody who is here listening to this, everyone who will watch this, everyone we encounter, everyone should be able to use what it is that they have, their skills, their interests, to push against this. So it's important for us to recognize that there are many ways to stop this assault. One of the very big ones, and I talk about this frequently, is when we talk about elections matter, they don't just matter a little bit, and they don't just matter on a national level. They matter on a very local level. School board elections sometimes are won or lost by a handful of votes. And so if you are the person who says, well, it doesn't matter if I vote, and you don't go out and vote, and the school board that is elected is a slate, which is what happened here in Frederick County, Maryland, where I live, but we fought against it, a slate that says, we want education, not indoctrination, and we're going to be sure to do exactly what DeSantis is doing. That's what they wanted to do, get rid of an African-American studies course that was just implemented here, an elective, mind you, that wasn't even required. They wanted to stop teachers from being able to use students' preferred pronouns. But people went out and voted and beat them. But if we hadn't rallied folks to do that, they could have won. And in a space that you assume is blue, like Frederick County, it would have moved on to being a space that was run by this group of ultra right conservatives. And so when we talk about one thing we can do is make sure we cast our own vote. We can explain to people how important local elections are. We can do exactly what we're doing right here in this forum with the people who are out there, is learn this history. Because to your point, Dr. Jeffries, you said students are mad when they don't know this history. There's this kind of argument that goes on that says, oh, we don't want to make, and not an argument that goes on, we've heard people say it, we don't want to make students uncomfortable. When they say students, people are typically talking about white students. We don't want to make students uncomfortable by learning this history, never mind how Black students feel about being completely erased from that historical record. But what I have found in 20 some odd years of higher education is that students, regardless of color, are very upset when they find out what they didn't know. They want to know this history.
And then I've had the same experiences, but I've never had a student become mad at me. Like they don't get mad at us for teaching this. They get mad at their teachers previously who they had entrusted. They get mad at their parents, right, for not teaching them this. So you don't want to be that parent. You definitely don't want to be that teacher, right, who our kids would look back and be like, oh, I thought they were cool, but what happened, right? They left this stuff out. But I also think, like, there's this process. I've seen it. And I think this gets a little bit, David, to the question that you were, that you had offered. And Terry is spot on. This is the response is organizing, right? And this is we need an organizer's response to this. And all organizing begins locally. And everybody can contribute something. Not everybody has to do the same thing, but everybody can contribute something. But the students, I mean, they'll come in, those who haven't learned it, right? And they go through what I see as the five stages of grief, right? I mean, it's like denial, then it's anger, right? Then they're negotiating and bargaining, like, well, maybe my teacher didn't know. No, they knew, right? Maybe the governor doesn't really understand. No, he knows, right? But then they get depressed. Like, well, damn, well, what does this mean about the society? That's the discomfort, right? It is uncomfortable. But in the end, they get to that acceptance, right? And that acceptance is one thing. Like, as teachers, we say, oh, it's great to, you know, get the students to the acceptance so they understand and recognize and acknowledge the history. But this generation of young people, and, you know, this generation, I mean, really like the last 15 years or so, right? So this is those who were born during the Obama era or really came of political age during Obama's presidency. This is an activist generation, right? I mean, because, you know, the Occupy Wall Street, Black Lives Matter. I mean, so many wonderful organizations, March for Our Lives. And then, of course, 2020. And this is what is so threatening. They go through that process when you share with them this history, honestly. And then after acceptance, they go to a sixth stage that's not about grief. And that sixth stage is from acceptance to action. They're taking action. And that's what the great fear is that if you share this history, if you share, and this is not just we're worried about radicalizing Black kids, right? It's like, no, they're a little bit worried about us. They're worried about the white kids, right? They're like, God damn, like if they keep on this track, then they're gonna be with the Black kids and it's all over, right? I mean, that's that action step. So the kids get it and that's what they don't want, but it is very much an organizing question.
Okay, great. That's powerful to hear the way you two articulate this, which leads me to make a statement about Dr. Terry Ann Scott and the Institute for Common Power, okay? Because I believe one of those organizing necessities in this age of politicized education, where arguments are fought out about education in the political space, is that there needs to be some forces that are not just institutionalized educators, but that are para-educational organizations that are pushing on the center left, from the center left, all right? We have all of these organizations on the right and the far right that have been critiquing education from the UDC onwards, right? That have been making the case. But there are so few center left and left progressive organizations that are actually making the case for an inclusive, just, honest assessment of American history. Where's the heirs of the Howard Zinns? Where are they today? They didn't create organizing organizations today, they are either educators or they're marching in the streets or they're working for, a kind of healthcare organization that is doing great work. But we need an organization that can make the case and push hard and provide a forum for a just and inclusive democracy. And that's where the Institute for Common Power comes in, is we are distinctly created to do just what we're doing right here tonight, right now, and where we're going to go. And so tonight is not only about the brilliance of you, Dr. Jeffries, and the content that you're bringing tonight. It's also about helping everybody who's joining this call to know that we have a vision here with the Institute for Common Power. There is a vision here. We do not have it all yet, do we, Terry? We don't know it all. We don't know it all. But we have a drive and a sense of where we're going. So I want to pause for a second there, come back to some of the kind of historical content, but turn it to you, Terry. I think it's important for you to say a little bit about what we're trying to do in a general sense with the Institute for Common Power, beyond just the initiative. What is the broader kind of positionality of where the Institute's trying to go? And kindly enough, Dr. Jeffries seems to be willing to go with us for a chunk of this, at least.
Dr. Jeffries is willing to go with us, and it is one of the things, Dr. Jeffries, that we respect so much about you, because you are an educator who does not see your role confined to a collegiate campus. You see your role as an individual who takes it outside of the campus as you educate students to go outside and create a better world, and as you yourself go into the community to help forge that better world. So we honor you, we honor academics who are like you. And so, yes, we would like, we will go further together, as we say, in common power. One of the things that we are able to do with the Institute for Common Power, and we can't deny the position that we have in this institute, there are many other academics who are fearful. And that is the point of what is much of what is happening across the country, in Florida and other spaces, to quiet academics. When we traveled last year to Texas, we talked to an elementary school educator. There had not been any legal dictates handed out yet, but he said, I'm afraid to talk about the truth. That is the intent of what's happening. And we are here to try to support people and bring them out of that fear in any way that we possibly can. Our motto in the Institute for Common Power is education to action. Because once we understand what has happened before us, once we understand, so the things that you were talking about, Dr. Jeffries, the gravity of the situation, the creation of things like Daughters of the Confederacy, the intentionality behind much of what they have intended to do, and also the Black agency that fought against that. That's the kind of thing that sustains us in the work that we are doing. And so we have a broad approach to this. We educate educators. We give them scholarships, as I mentioned at the beginning of this program, to teach them this history, to help sustain them in this work. And we have people like you, Dr. Jeffries, who are here with us this evening to help educate people, to motivate them. And we take it a step further in that once you have come here to talk about this, Dr. Jeffries gave us some examples, some outlines of the kinds of things that we can do, ordinary people doing extraordinary things, starting things like freedom schools. Dr. Carter G. Woodson, starting an organization in 1915 that is now today the largest African-American organization for African-American culture and history in the world. Ordinary people doing extraordinary things. That's what we are here for. And so we welcome people into the fold. Go ahead. And I was going to ask Dr. Jeffries a question after that.
Yeah, go ahead, Terry.
Okay. So I have a question for you, Dr. Jeffries, because one of the things that continues to circulate, and I know people ask this of us all the time, and I'm glad that you started to get at this very much so in your lecture, is the why. Why is this happening? Why are people trying to stop the truth? And I love how you began to talk about systemic racism and the choices that people have. Can you, and David's holding up, what is it? A seminal work on that. Can you address, and that's one of the questions that's in the question and answer, why? Why is this happening? That is a $1 million question that people who are not on board with this want to understand.
Yeah, I think the answer to that is, It's pretty straightforward, right? So the why is, like, why is this happening is a political question. The answer is politics, right? I mean, this is, like, it's being driven by politics, the critical race theory hysteria was drummed up political hysteria. We literally know it was a manufactured crisis. You know, we can look at the Heritage Foundation and these other foundations that are explicit in saying, we are going to create a buzzword around this issue of critical race theory to drum up support so that it will help us undo not just what is being taught in the classrooms, but any initiative, any work around diversity, equity, inclusion, and justice, right? I mean, so education and making education sort of the front line of this, of a battle to limit all type of equity work. And so we see what's going on in Florida is, you know, we're gonna animate people around this issue, but the purpose is to stop what's been making progress in leading up to this moment. Certainly 2020 and the protests, you know, are sort of a triggering mechanism for this, but it's only because gains had actually been made, right? Real progress had been happening slower than, you know, most of us would like. We're still dealing with the legacy of all this, but it was still moving in a forward direction. And so that was really important. So I think the why is pretty straightforward. This is politics. And so, you know, part of the response, David, as you were asking, we need a political response. We need organizations. The organizations on the right, well-funded, are pushing this. So we're going to have organizations on the left who have the people power behind them, yes, to respond. The more difficult and I think more complicated question is, why are people going along with it? Why are so many white folk going along with it? Now, we know that it's actually not that many people who are showing up at these school board meetings, right? I mean, it's a vocal minority who are creating chaos, right? We understand that. But still, what is it about this messaging that is resonating with so many white people, right? Because it ain't black people, again, it ain't black people, it ain't Latin people, you know, Latinx folk who are getting on board with this, right? What is it about this white demographic that says, like, this is what we want? Political conservatives, religious conservatives, right? I mean, all of that gets wrapped up in this. What is their investment in making sure that this history isn't taught? And, you know, I think in part, we have to look at, you know, this effort to preserve a particular worldview that is, you know, that is Christian, that is Christian nationalist, right, that is rooted in a belief in white supremacy, very insular, right? I mean, all of that then plays out. And so if we can target that and what's going on there, I think we have to, that has to be part of the response as well. Yeah. But we also have to recognize, and this is part of the troubling, this is part of the aspect that I think a lot of folk don't necessarily get. And this is why, David, your question about what do we do, and Terry, your response, we've got to organize, is so important. Like, facts just aren't enough.
They are not.
Like, no.
We can't just say, look, this is the history that happened, and that's not, like, that's not enough. That's not enough. This is about power, right? Yeah. This is about accessing power, mobilizing power for change, because just presenting the information we already know is not enough to move people off of their entrenched positions.
Yep. Yeah, and I want to stay on one thing about that when you said about power, because when you were lecturing, you said, and I think about this all the time, but people, enslaved people, it was illegal for them to learn to read and write. Why? Because knowledge is power. And so when we talk about why this is happening, the ones who are in the power position, their intentions are even more nefarious. If you can keep people ignorant, then you disempower them. And so we have to understand how that power relationship goes in so many ways. And you also mentioned that vocal minority creating chaos. That is such an extreme point that I don't want to gloss over. Because when people say, what can I do? That vocal minority, it is a vocal minority. And if you can rally your neighbors and your friends and other people, and you find out when the school board meetings are, and you post them, and you text people, it works. I know, I've done it. And they show up. And they drown out the voices of the dissenters. And then the school board and the media and others have to pay attention. That's an easy power for you to exercise.
Yeah, just to reiterate that point, one of the lessons that we're seeing in this moment is that it's not a lot of people. But one of the lessons that we saw during the civil rights movement, or the height of the civil rights movement in the 50s and 60s, is that we like to think. I encounter students all the time. They're having a protest. They're like, I'm like, you know, I see them afterwards. They're like, how'd the protest go? I'm like, oh, Dr. Jeff, we only had 60 people. And I'm like, how many did you think? They're like, well, there's 60,000 students at Ohio State. Like, you thought you were going to get all of them? Like, that ain't going to happen. But that's how we think about the civil rights movement. Like, everybody was out on the streets, right? The March on Washington had millions of people. It was 250,000. The point, the lesson of the civil rights movement that is often lost is that it actually wasn't a lot of people. Mm-hmm. It does not take a lot of people to make a big difference. Just as we're seeing on the political right, we've seen that historically on the left, but it has to be an organized people and not just mobilized, but organized so that mm-hmm. they can have a sustained impact.
Okay, want to take a pause here and for a second and say thank you. Karen in the Q&A said, what is the plan and how can we get involved? Well, I want to address that and say that Dr. Terry and I and Dr. Jeffries don't come tonight with a call to march on Washington. We don't. But there will be actions that will be asked for and announced as we go. We do what we do at Common Power, though, is we start with a grounding historically. We start with a grounding historically, and that's what we're doing tonight. So tonight, the plan, and what is the plan? The plan is this. The plan is exactly this right now. It's us having a meeting, a conversation here, where we build a common language among us that the reality is that this is not new, and there have been successes before. And those successes, those Black advancements, is what Dr. Carol Anderson in White Rage has articulated always produces white rage, is Black advancement, Black success, yeah. Black yeah. excellence, always yeah. met by that, by a white response that responds negatively, powerfully, violently, viscerally against it. To the extent that I have often said that the deal we made as a country was that if you wanted Barack Obama and you didn't know it, but you were going to get Donald Trump after Barack Obama. That's the deal that was made. Yep. But the white progressives are like shocked that this would happen, right? And Black people are like, I told you this was coming, okay? And so Black people are like, again, the truth tellers in this enterprise. Yeah. Here's the piece I want to put on the table, though, in response to a point you made, because I want this to be part of the conversation for the Institute going forward. Let's imagine the white rage that is present in American life. And I am fully aware that I, as a white man, stand in the legacy of that, and I'm determined to not repeat that, okay? But let's imagine that white rage is a lake, a reservoir. And I would say that, in my view, that lake covered most of the United States for a long time. And then that lake got a little bit smaller over time after Reconstruction. Reconstruction made some inroads, but it was still way too big, still too big. So it still drowned out and buried those successes. And then the Civil Rights Movement made that lake shrink a little bit more, but only through pain and death and incredible work, but that lake shrunk. And then the Black Lives Matter body of work in the last decade and the protests post George Floyd, in my view, have shrank that lake a little bit more, okay? The lake is still enormous and way larger than any of us would want. But I believe that that lake has evaporated over time, okay? It's evaporating. And it's evaporating not out of natural causes, but because of the incredible work for freedom and for struggle that has gone on for a long time. Okay, so it is evaporating because of work, because of organizing work. And I would take it to the, so I wanted to hear your response to that. And I would take it to the point of right now, I think the lake that is out there that is ready to be valuable to the critical race theory arguers and the DeSantis arguers is actually not near as large as they think it is. It is not near as large as they think it is. They've taken two instances, Glenn Youngkin's victory in Virginia in 2021 and Ron DeSantis's success in Florida. They've taken those two instances, which are clearly political wins for the kind of anti-woke body of folks, right? But they have extrapolated from those to a national strategy that I do not think is a winning national strategy, actually. I think it's a losing national strategy. If center left mobilizes, right? If the center left organizes and mobilizes. But I don't think the lake is near as big as they think. So I enter this space with, anger that there's a lake at all, but a belief also that the lake is not as drowning and as dangerous to us as it has been in the past, and that we can win today. Mm-hmm. Today. Yeah. I wanted to get your responses to those two, to those sensibilities, that the lake has been shrinking. Do you agree with that? Mm-hmm. And how big do you think that lake is today?
Yeah. So yes, to stay with the, to stay with your framework, I do believe the lake has been shrinking for the reasons that you say. In other words, not by itself, not natural evaporation, but because of the hard work that other people have been doing. That's a measure of progress, right? In the sense that, you know, gains, substantial and real and meaningful gains, have occurred over time as a result of people's work. I think the challenge is in understanding that relationship, because we are saddled, I think, as a nation with a belief in the myth of perpetual racial progress, that things may have been bad once, but they always get better. So they may recognize that the lake has been shrinking, but they won't recognize that it's only shrunk because people have been willing to fight to make it so, right? I mean, Dr. King used to talk about the arc of the moral universe, you know, bends towards justice. And that makes us feel good. Like, okay, but that's but we leave off the part that King says, it's like it only bends in that direction if you're willing to exert a force necessary to bend it in that direction. Because we'll fall back, and we saw this during the Trump years, right? We saw this during the 4 years. It will fall back on time, right? And say, oh, just give it time and it will change, right? That, and that's exactly, David, what you're not saying. Like, time is not a social force capable of creating change. It's just a unit of measure. If you allow time to proceed, time to unfold without doing something, the only thing that will happen is to reinforce the status quo. Nothing will change. In fact, things will get worse. And so in that sense, I think you're absolutely right. We've seen progress. Progress is real only because people have been willing to fight from day one in order to gain that progress. Now, the depth of the, you know, how widespread this is, you know, I don't know. I fear sometimes that it's wider than I actually want it to. I believe it is. I'm just not sure. I'm not willing to just sort of wait, though, and find out how wide it is. But part of my worry and concern, though, about its size is that we're not playing on equal terms. So it's not like, okay, this is your team, this is our team, let's battle this out, right? It's like, this is your team with the Supreme Court that's allowing you to gerrymander districts, right? And that, so it's not an even playing field in terms of the structures and power with that be. That concerns me, because as long as those on the political right are able to cheat in this particular way, are able to suppress voters, are able to gerrymander districts, are able to disenfranchise people, they have a distinct advantage in the current moment. And we have to fight, you know, to sort of roll back and hold the line, but we also have to fight to get on, to get a fairer playing field at the same time. That's a challenge.
Yeah, and I agreed with everything. First thing I do want to say, you said that Karen asked what are next steps. Yes, we're grounding this in a conversation now, but I want to tell everybody next steps are coming. We have things and ways that people can get involved, and we're going to let you know about those. So stay tuned for that. Is the lake shrinking? Yes, the lake is shrinking, and those on the political right who are in power structure to disempower us and disenfranchise us know it is shrinking, and that is why they are implementing so many disenfranchising measures. That is why voter suppression has been kicked up since 2020. That is why the Supreme Court ruling in 2013 came down in the years following the election of a Barack Obama. It is a historical parallel that we see in the post-Reconstruction era, when you have so much political agency and Black political power that 100 years of a Jim Crow regime emerge to stop, quote unquote, Negro domination. But the one thing about that shrinking lake is it's not small enough, right? Yeah. 76 million people, was it, voted for Trump? That's a second time, time. That's extraordinary.
After they knew, no secrets, right? Like, you knew, if you didn't know before, you knew now.
That's exactly right. There are no secrets anymore. You consciously did it a second time. And that is not just something to flippantly look at. That places people's actual lives and livelihood in danger. that seeks to reinforce the kind of systemic racism, Dr. Jeffries, that you were talking about tonight. And yes, the lake is shrinking, and we always have to remember that, because if we say it's not, that discounts the kind of work and sacrifices that our pioneers have done, that our foot soldiers have done, that we celebrated this past weekend in Jubilee. I have so many students who have said, and I'm sure both of you have had this as well, it's worse now than it ever was. You know, we have a lot of work to do, but it's a hell of a lot better. I don't have to worry about being lynched when I go knock on doors in Texas to register people to vote. We have come a long way, and we must acknowledge that, because that lets us know that we can do more. Some of the fish in that lake, though, bite real hard right now. They are empowered. That's why we saw what we saw on January 6th. They are empowered. And so we have to always keep that in mind so that we can organize and fight against it. Yeah.
Can we go maybe 10, 15 more minutes, you guys?
Yeah.
Or 10, 15 more years? You good?
The lifetime.
I want to ask you a question that's come up in the Q&A. What is the personal cost to you, each of you, for taking public positions like you are taking right now? You each could be in your classrooms teaching the knowledge and the truths. You both have written incredible books. You know the knowledge, the history. I could listen to you all day. What's the personal cost to being vocal like this? And I'll start with you, Dr. Jeffries, and then Dr. Scott.
Yeah, we were actually talking about this a little bit offline right before we began. I mean, the personal cost is measurable in my inbox, is measurable on my phone, in the death threats, in the threats in general, in the death threats. In the fact that there's somebody right now who's sitting in federal prison, serving a 2-year sentence because of threats that he made to myself and my family. Wow. And my brother and others. I mean, so those are real. It's something that is unfortunate, but it's a reality of the times in which we live. And so, like, I'm well aware when having conversations like this, and I'm encouraging teachers, you know, to dig deep, to challenge and to stand up for what's right. I'm not, you know, saying that, you know, as somebody who doesn't understand sort of the risks in doing so. But I also understand that, you know, there were others before us who risked a whole lot too. And if we're not willing to risk something, you're not guaranteed to be safe in this work. Just period, right? I mean, you can lose your job, you can lose your livelihood, you can lose your life. But so too did those young people who turned out in the streets and they were facing those police. If they can face them, then we can face our school principal. Amen. We can face our school board. We can face our boss when we're standing on the right side of history and we're standing for justice.
Yes, we begin and end that with what you just said. If they can face that, we can do this. We can do because they did. I won't even pretend to say that my threats have measured yours. We only had to call, administration had to call the police only one time when I was on campus here. For a threat leveled against me and some students I was working with. You've had to call, your administration has had to call the police and other agencies multiple times. And my heart goes out to you and your family because, and I think people can begin to think about this, when that happened, I was teaching a night course and every single class that ended, my husband came to pick me up and waited in the parking lot because of the fear that it engendered, because of the concern that he had. So this also can take a toll. So that's my incident there. In addition, you know, we get the hate mail and all of those kinds of things. But you have faced much, much more. But your point is well taken and should be understood in some sense. Not that it doesn't matter, but we understand that it is worthwhile because of the path that we can carve and because of what other people have faced that we have not had to face.
Okay. Look, I'm deeply appreciative and don't face that vitriol. I know that. in the same way. I can fight for this and never face that same kind of vitriol. I could still be damaged and hurt and physically under assault, but you live in the, because of your identities, face that in a different way. And so I stand in respect. I stand in respect to you both for that. I got a couple more questions. We'll try to get through these quick because I think these are really interesting. Do we think in terms of a political argument that there is a valuable political argument to start to be made, starting really right now, that children in states where education is being suppressed are being hurt in terms of their college educational and professional futures? So if they're going through K-12 institutions where they're not getting the full teachings of history, right? Can we begin to make that argument with an integrity that you can leave your kids in that system, but that's the pay, you're going to pay the price for that?
Go ahead, Terry.
Oh, I was going to say, so at the end of the quarter, semester, wherever you work, when you are teaching in higher education, you get evaluations, right? And they're typically anonymous evaluations. Well, whether I was at the University of Washington, when I was at Bellevue College before that, when I was at Hood College, it doesn't matter. I can't tell you how many times I have had students who are white students who have not identified their names, but who have said, I was raised to think a particular way about Black people. And now that I've learned these other things, thank you for opening my mind or my heart. Thank you for teaching me something else. And I know you have gotten those as well. And so how does that answer? Are these students hurt? Absolutely, they're hurt. Because if those students are taught to think a particular way, what does that mean? I was raised to be a racist, to be racist against these individuals, to harbor some type of bias and animosity or fear against these individuals. And this has broken that down. That is the power of understanding truth. In those singular stories over the course of time at different universities and colleges in different parts of the country. And so you multiply that by so many others. And the antithesis of that is something else as well. Sometimes we assume that Black people in general assume that Black kids are born knowing this history. They're going through the same educational programs that everybody else is. They don't know this history either. And so they need to be taught it. And if they're not taught it at home and they come to classes, then they are taught it. Then not only does that help to break down barriers between them and others, it allows them in a society that continuously says Blackness is lower, Blackness is on a lower rung of the racial hierarchy. It allows them to see themselves as heroic, as the builders of a society, as the ones whom have created the kind of world that we have, the wealth that we see around this country as heroes in this narrative.
Terry's spot on. I mean, you just mapped out the harm that is done to students, and that will extend over generations, because we know we're feeling the impact of that harm for not teaching this for generations. We're seeing it in the classroom mm-hmm. now. We're seeing mm-hmm. the ways in which it's manifesting in politics and the things that people are willing to go along with, and so that will just continue on. We will lose, we will move forward, we will move backward, we will lose the progress that we have gained if we don't teach this. I want to add a wrinkle to it. How can we use that, thinking about the organizing aspect,
right?
How can we use that to our advantage?
Yeah.
We saw a model, Indiana, you know, home of former Vice President Mike Pence, right? He ain't no raging radical, right? At least on the left side, right? So, but Indiana did not have a divisive issues bill succeed in passing its legislature. Mm. Why? Because when they tried, when they put that introduced it into the state legislature, what happened was parents and educators, African-American and like in Indianapolis and some of the other urban areas, they connected with suburban whites. And they said, if you pass this, the history that you are teaching in the classroom will not be accurate. It will not be complete, it will not be full. And therefore, not just that your children won't be getting a full, robust, quality education, but they won't be, this is the thing, we might lose our AP status.
Yeah.
We might not be able to teach AP government, AP history right? AP US history, AP world history. If we lose this, and God forbid if your kid doesn't have those AP classes, then you know your dreams of Harvard and Yale are all out the window. And so that actually worked, right? And that was before the College Board actually got dragged into this in Florida. Mm-hmm. I think if we can get serious, and the College Board has changed its tune a little bit, right? I mean, they're about making profit, right? I mean, that's what this is. But if somehow we put pressure on them and we would put pressure on others to say, you know what? You're not going to teach AP African-American studies, then you're not going to teach AP history. You're not going to teach AP biology, all of it. Like, imagine
if
the states lost that, right? Boy, oh, I don't care. Those suburban moms who are investing all that in their kids going into college and they can't have AP credits, that would, you're talking about changing things completely. It's one thing if you lose African-American studies, they ain't planning on having their kid go take that class anyway. But if now you're saying, like, you want to play this game, here you go. That becomes, I think, that could be a potential game changer.
I 100% agree. And this is where these moments that have occurred politically that seem to be victories for the right and for DeSantis et al., to me, actually are points that can be leveraged strongly against them. So you want Florida to not teach African American studies, then we'll pressure the College Board to do exactly what you're saying, Dr. Jeffries. And also, if Florida becomes that educational space of the removal of tenure protections and the inability to teach about a variety of concepts because of the legislature and the governor's push, fine, then those kids are going to be turned into a political football in the national political space. Yeah. And they become the kind of don't become the next Florida in the arguments. And you know what? Florida might be working just fine for Florida, but there's an awful lot of people in North Carolina that don't want to be the next Florida, right?
Yep.
And the same thing at the higher ed level, right? What if our companies and corporations said, you know what? We no longer value the education coming out from Florida schools. We're not, or law school, right? It's like, you know what? We're not taking Florida students, because if this is their education, not only K-12, but college, even just the conversation around that would shake people to the core.
Yeah.
Amen.
Okay, we're going to start to wind up here. And I know that, I think, Dr. Terry, you have a couple kind of next steps for us. But I just want to say thank you to you both, and to this work tonight, and to committing to this. And we at Common Power, with Terry in our leadership as director of the Institute for Common Power, we've made a decision that we can't just teach about this. It's not enough to know more. We need to do more and do better. We need to. And so we're committed as an organization to doing. We always have been committed to action. And so some of you have asked in the Q&A just a reference about who's this book is by, White Rage, by Dr. Carol Anderson, professor at Emory University. It's a great book. I particularly recommend it to white Americans because the reality is that the problem, the racial problem in America, of course, lies with us. It does. And I want to answer the question I put forward to the two of you earlier. I think that one of the very first things that has to happen is for white people to say, I accept. I accept. Okay. I accept that. Okay. Now, I don't need to live with the I acceptance on a daily. I can actually turn that to movement, to work. Right. So thank you both for helping to direct us and to guide us. Terry, I'm going to toss it to you. Okay.
David, thank you for your honesty. Thank you for your example of how to move forward in this work. Very much appreciated. Everyone out there, we are honored to say that Dr. Jeffries, we're not done with you. I hope that's okay, Dr. Jeffries. First of all, we have something called our foundational courses. So we continue this learning and this education to action. And in May, Dr. Jeffries will be teaching a course, one lecture per week for the course of 4 weeks over May. And so everybody who is registered in your email, you will receive an email from me tomorrow, and there will be a direct link for you to register for his course. And so it is on the US civil rights movement. And once you look at the registration link, it'll break down what each one of those classes is going to be. So you will have full access be able to ask Dr. Jeffries questions and learn from him. You already got a taste of how incredible he is as a scholar, as a philosopher, as an activist. And so you'll be able to continue that on. That's number one. Number two, in that email, we are also going to send you some of our next steps, how you can become one of those organizers, because that's what we do in Common Power. The Institute for Common Power is education to action. Much of that action comes in our parent organization, Common Power. And we have a multi-generational, multi-racial model where people are working together to create change. So we will send you that information. On April 5th, we're gonna have an informational session, David and I, that will talk about all the different things that we do and that you can get involved. You just have to register and show up, and we'll have a link for you to do that. We don't want to see this as a one time and then you're gone. We want you to come into the fold of the work that we are doing. So we'll let you know. We also have some other things planned where we are not letting Florida go. We're going to confront what's happening there in a very, I already use the word confront, but maybe a confrontational way, in a way that is going to kick up some dust. So, and Dr. Jeffries is going to join us in that effort, as are many, many other scholars from around the country. So we thank you for that. We thank you for being so generous with your time and your knowledge this evening. And for everybody out there, this is the beginning, not the end of this conversation and of these actions. So we will see you very soon. Thank you so much for joining us. And thank you, Dr. Thank Jeffries.
You. Absolutely. Thank you, Terry. Thank you, David. Thank you, everyone. Let's keep going. Good trouble.
Amen. David out. All right, let's stop the recording.
Okay.